Good morning and welcome to Restoration. We're so glad you're here, and we're continuing to begin these Lenten Sundays with a processional. So we take a moment now to quiet yourselves here in the Lord's dwelling place.
Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee.
Bless the Lord, who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
Let's pray together, preparing our hearts for this morning of worship. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your soul. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets.
Holy God, holy mighty, holy, Lord of one, have mercy. thousands elsewhere.
As we think about dwelling, the Resto Arts team is trying to help you think about dwelling in the Lord's home. You see trees coming up behind me. There's trees at the narthex doors, birds' nests around you. These are inspirations for dwelling places that we get to dwell with the Lord all the time, not just in heaven, but now. What is that like? So be inspired by these trees as you think about taking shelter with them, dwelling in the Lord's protection. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities that may happen to the body and from all evil thoughts that may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. This morning we're going to pray for Coracle as one of our outreach partners. Some of you have partaken in their fellows program. Some of you have participated in the small groups where they're lamenting racial division, seeking reconciliation there. They're down in Quicksburg, but we have Coracle representatives in our midst. Drew Masterson's in the back. Susan Denherter attends Restoration as well. So let's pray for them. Their fellows program, I know the Leas has just finished it. Their fellows program starts, they're taking applications in May. So if you're interested, that piques your interest, check out their website for more. But let's pray for Bill Haley and his team. Lord, thank you for this place, Coracle, for the spiritual formation and kingdom action that comes out of them, that draws others to them. Thank you for the work they're doing. And we pray for Bill and Susan and Drew and the rest of their team, that they'd be inspired by you and your creativity, your healing work amongst us. You'd give them all they need as they minister to others and guide us all as we journey with you. Will you bless them, Lord? And will you bless our kids as they get ready to learn and grow in you together? Guide their leaders, fill them with your joy. May you always be their shelter, the place where they abide and dwell. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. If you are in fifth grade or below, you can head to the back and meet your leaders. Otherwise, please put on a name tag and meet your neighbor.
It's like everything I wear.
A reading from Isaiah. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you, because you were precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. I give men in return for you, peoples in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth, everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, who I formed and made. The word of the Lord.
Please join me in praying Psalm 91 responsively by whole verse. Whoever dwells under the defense of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say unto the Lord, you are my refuge and my stronghold, my God in whom I will trust. For he shall deliver you from the snare of the hunter and from the deadly pestilence. He shall defend you under his wings, and you shall be safe under his feathers. His faithfulness and truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of any terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the sickness that destroys at noonday. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and never shall be, world without end. Amen.
Please stand for the reading of the Gospel. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
He went on his way through the towns and villages, teaching and journeying towards Jerusalem. And someone just said to him, Lord, will those who are saved be few? And he said to them, strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, open to us, then he will answer you, I do not know where you come from. Then you will begin to say, we ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets. But he will say, I tell you, I do not know where you come from. Depart from me, all you workers of evil. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves cast out. And people will come from east and west and from north and south and recline at the table in the kingdom of God. And behold, some are last who will be first, and some are first who will be last. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Please be seated. Good morning, everybody. My name is David. You are the brave ones who braved daylight savings time and came. It's good to see you all. Thank you for being here this morning. Both Jesus and Isaiah talk about people coming from the east, the west, the north, and the south. Isaiah describes God bringing sons and daughters home from the east and west. They will be gathered, is the way he describes it. From the north and south, God will say to north and south, give them up. From the ends of the earth, he will bring home everyone who is called by his name. And Isaiah describes, like, bringing them home will involve safe passage through waters, rivers, fire, flame, challenging circumstances that we will need not fear, for he is redeemed. He's called us by name, and he will get you home. For thus says the Lord, who created you. Jesus describes people coming from the east and west and north and south, and they will recline at table in the kingdom of God. They will get to that table through a, quote, narrow door. It's often an image that's invoked to describe, as Jesus says, how few will get through it. But it's another image that describes hope. There's a door. And God has made a way. And behold, make sure you note, you will be very surprised by who is sitting at that table. For some who are last will be first, and some who are first will be last. God has a way of bringing his people home, east, west, north, south. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you know our names, and thank you for giving us yours, identifying us as yours. It is a mighty name, and it makes a way for us to come home. Today, as we talk about Psalm 91, it is hard to talk about protection when we see so many people in danger. And it is hard to talk about coming home when we see so many people who aren't. So we thank you for our circumstance. We don't take it for granted. And we thank you that you give us words to pray into the circumstances of others, that they might experience something different. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. So, Lent. Lent is a season of turning. And Lent is a season that is animated by our choices. We choose to turn away from distraction, to turn away from comfort. We choose prayer, we choose to give, we choose to turn towards the Lord. We talked about that on Ash Wednesday. And a frequently used biblical image for turning to the Lord is this idea of coming home, to find shelter, refuge, security, protection. God bringing his sons and daughters home from the east, west, north, and south, through rivers and flame, through narrow doors, so that they are home, dwelling in the shadow of the Almighty, feasting at table in the kingdom of God. So during Lent, we are preaching from book 4 of the book of Psalms, the Psalms of the 90s. And it turns out that in Chris Stevens and his brilliance, we're also singing songs of the 90s. So Better Is One Day took me right back to like 97, I think, or so. So I want to invite you to turn to page 497 in the Bible that's in front of you. That is Psalm 91. I'd love for you to follow along. I'll also have some stuff on the screen behind me. Psalm 91 is a commercial for our God. From beginning to end, it is just straight up, this is how awesome our God is. It's a prayer that describes where we can put our confidence as we move through circumstances that really should just be overwhelming to us. Psalm 91 is real. Life really is this dangerous. We see it all the time. And God really is this trustworthy. Few psalms are as encouraging as this one, and it's probably familiar to you because of that. And yet, because the promises are so desirable, and because the promises are potentially so experientially elusive to us, this psalm can raise some hard questions, especially when we are in hard circumstance. But let's see how it flows. It starts with a pitch. So Psalm 91:1 says, "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty." I've read this many times this week, every day, kind of coming back to this verse. And I keep saying to God, "God, this sounds pretty amazing. He dwells in the shelter of the Most High. He will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. What is it?" And finally, God gave me a picture of what this is. So I drew it for you. There's an NFT attached, so don't like pull out your phone or anything like that. But I mean, that's kind of it, right? Like, that's where I live. It's not as good what Beth could do, but that's just what I could sort of pull out. This could be on a billboard somewhere. Where do you want to live? If you lived here, you could be home now. This is where you want to be. If you choose this as your place, the shelter of the Most High, you will find safe lodging. Now, the emphasis is on choose. To paraphrase our airlines, we know you have a choice in dwelling places. Thank you for choosing the shelter of the Most High. Not everyone does. Not everyone is home. And so we go to Psalm, to verse 2. For those who have, verse 2 describes the effect on our soul and our demeanor. We exhale as we walk through the door. Beth led us in prayer that way this morning, and I had written that a few days ago. We exhale as we walk through the door. I'm in a safe place. I can say to the Lord three uniquely personal things. my refuge, my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. So living in his shadow is living in his care and receiving his personal attention. The use of shadow and shelter, think of very defined spaces, homes. It's instructive to us about how this works because you know when you are in it. I'm in the shadow right now. I'm inside the house right now. And you know when you are not. When you are in it, you experience deep calm from a source outside yourself, just like we prayed in the collect this morning. And when you aren't, well, you know what that's like too. You're on your own. You're on your own. And sometimes that works, and sometimes it doesn't. So the psalm starts with a pitch for what happens when you make this choice. You have a safe place with my refuge, my fortress, my God. And then verses 3-8 describe all the benefits of what it's like to be there. Because we don't always stay at home. We actually journey out, and we find that the shadow comes with us. So go to verses 3-8. He says, he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. So the psalmist describes very real dangers that we are very much susceptible to, that we could very much encounter. So he describes that we're delivered from the snare of the fowler. The fowler, that's a word that I really never use, but I'm actually hoping that someday I'm going to be standing in that narthex and someone's going to come up to me and say, hey, I'm Shirley, I'm a fowler. That'd be cool, because I will respond, good morning, my name is David, I'm a shepherd. Yes, I like sheep. A fowler is someone who hunts fowl birds and who hunts birds and traps them. It is an awful feeling to feel like you have been taken advantage of, to come to a realization that through deception, you are now stuck. That's an awful feeling. Your identity or your credit card has been stolen. Your child or your spouse has lied about their whereabouts. Your coworker has been discounting your performance and poisoning your reputation. A snare is an awful place to be, and almost by definition, we can't take them off by ourselves. And so the psalm says, in the shadow of the Almighty, he will deliver you. Deadly pestilence. This was a word we used a lot regularly at morning and evening prayer during the pandemic. We would pray, deliver us from this pestilent coronavirus. Pestilence is real. However, quick Hebrew lesson. Hebrew is a language of consonants. So Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet, He, those are like consonants in the alphabet. Sometimes a word can have the same consonant order, and by making different vowel markings, it becomes something totally different, and that's the case here. So with the Hebrew word for pestilence, if you take the same consonants and adjust the vowel markings just a little bit, you get the word for slander, false statements that damage your reputation. Scholars read this and they say both pestilence and slander are great translations of this word, and there's actual textual evidence that's for both, fits the context. And so we can say, yes, deadly pestilence, as we walk through pandemics and plagues, he'll deliver us. But he'll also rescue us from deadly slander, those words that get out and then become out of your control and make you feel trapped. In the shadow of the Almighty, he will deliver you. The psalmist goes on, you will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, the destruction that wastes at noonday. God's people have been migrants since the very call of Abraham, and we today move through a world where evil still flourishes. We experience physical, emotional, spiritual danger, and our fears can keep us awake at night. They can make us paralyzed and immobile during the day. In the shadow of the Almighty, you will not fear. In all of these, God is more than adequate. The psalmist says, 1,000 may fall at your side. War has been a constant reality for humanity, and in the midst of it, brave warriors lean on their physical strength while depending on the strength of the one who is almighty. This psalm sings that whatever is taking out the thousands and the 10,000s around you, it will not come near you. In the shadow of the Almighty, you will see the recompense, the just punishment of the wicked. These are the very real dangers that we face. And we know that some people face them in ways that are even more stark and difficult than we do. And our hearts go out to them. Our hearts stay tender towards those situations. In verse 4, the psalmist gives two contrasting metaphors for the way God protects in the midst of all these dangers. So one is a mother bird gathering her brood under her wings. It was more descriptive in the one we read from our prayer book, but here in the ESV, you can see he covers you with his pinions. The other image is a fortress filled with shield and buckler. Both of those are protective devices. The fortress has walls of impregnable strength. Spears and arrows can't make a dent. The mother bird, however, shelters with wings that are fragile. She can only protect those who are underneath her from the sun's heat or the rain or the cold by bearing those things herself. God protects us with impervious strength and sacrificial, loving weakness. And we experience that. We, as followers of Jesus, experience that paradox through his Son, who was strong but became weak so that in our weakness we could experience his strength. It is on the cross where we see his absolute righteous power and his tender sacrificial love combine. We live in danger, but the awesome power and presence of God that we find in his shelter goes with us in our journeys. Home is a safe place, and God promises us safe passage. That is verses 3-8. Now, in the second half of this psalm, it takes a second run at the benefits of choosing the Lord as your dwelling place and your refuge. You can hear that he comes back to his theme. Because you've made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge, no evil shall be allowed to befall you. No plague shall come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Honestly, the promises become harder to read to you. It seems to be saying that nothing bad will happen to you. In fact, it says, no evil shall be allowed to befall you. And as we think about no evil, we think about a maternity hospital that was bombed in Kyiv this week. As we think about no plague, I think about how many tears I have shed for your loved ones who have died from COVID-19. How many tears you have shed for the way COVID-19 affected your life. He promises angels to guard you, stones that won't trip you, lions and snakes that won't eat you but will be trampled by you. Those are challenging words to accept as we live in a world that is recovering from pestilence and reeling from war. They seem a little tone deaf to our experience and to our news feeds. So let me wander from the psalm for a moment. For the devil knows that promises like these breathe life into his capacity to wedge doubt into our trusting hearts. The devil knows how to use these words. In the season of Lent, we always read the story of Jesus' temptation. We know that Satan found Jesus in the desert after the most expansive promise had been spoken over him. You are my beloved son. With you I am well pleased. I love you, Jesus. Jesus got to sit on those words for 40 days, that he was beloved and favored, and he was hungry and alone. And so the devil, after offering him bread from rocks and after offering him kingdoms from false worship, Satan settles on this. He goes here, right here to Psalm 91 to see if these words, these in particular, could drive a wedge between Jesus the Son and God the Father. He starts with, "No evil shall be allowed to befall you. How's the last 40 days been?" And then he follows up with, "Jesus, if you are the Son of God, if you are, throw yourself down from here, for it is written," we just read it, "he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And if a psalmist who lived hundreds of years before you could write it as an experience for God's people in general, how much more would it apply to you, you beloved Son of God? You're hungry, you're alone, you're supposedly beloved and favored. Why don't you take a dive right here and let the Father prove it to you? Because right now, you're just isolated, famished, and weak. Isolated, famished, and weak. This might be a good time to jump. In The Merchant of Venice, the merchant says the devil can cite scripture for his purpose. An evil soul producing holy witness is like a villain with a smiling cheek, a goodly apple rotten at the heart. Oh, what a goodly outside falsehood hath. I'm not great at Old English, but you get it. Shakespeare was brilliant on the human condition. And he uses words to describe the problem with words, that they can be misused, twisted, and insincere. And the devil has Jesus right there with this temptation. Is this true or is this not? Why don't you find out? So the devil twists by inviting Jesus to create an artificial crisis in order to shore up what he hopes is an inadequate confidence in his identity as beloved. You're not sure God really loves you, so why don't you throw yourself off the temple and test him? See if the angels come. Name this promise as you go on down. Read Psalm 91 as you're flying towards the ground and force God to fulfill it. Name it and try and lever him into it. Jesus responds to the devil, "I cannot presume on my Father. You shall not put the Lord your God to the test. I cannot create situations that presume God's protection. I can't throw myself off a building. I can't pick up snakes. I can't look for lions. Those things may come because we live in a world where they exist, but we aren't allowed to create drama for our own glory." Jesus knows what to say. But the other way this gets at us, the way that Satan uses it, is that Satan wants us to think that God's promises have failed us if he has allowed us circumstances where we suffer. And we see suffering everywhere in our life, in our lives around us. And so the temptation for us is to think that these words are not true. And that's a very real temptation for me and for you. And so I want to invite you to consider a deep lesson of maturity in your relationship with Christ. I want to invite you to take a deep step of growth right now. Because what Psalm 91 says to us is that the only things that faithful people can lose in suffering are things that are finally expendable. The real you, the one God is creating for eternity, the one that is in the shadow of the Almighty, cannot be harmed. Even as so many things around us are challenging and so much suffering is evident. Hold on to that for a moment as we come to the way this psalm ends. Hold on to that. Psalm 91 is distinctive because it's the only psalm, this is the only one, where God actually shows up and responds to the passionate, faithful prayer of those who rely on him. Everyone who reads this agrees that as we come to verse 14, it is God's voice that takes over. It is God who inspires the one who is writing this psalm to say, this is what I would say. If someone's praying this, this is what I would speak back to that person. And in verse 14, God says to the psalmist and to us, because he holds fast in love to me, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. God makes seven promises, four that are for very immediate, right in the present, three that are for later. He makes seven promises to the one who holds fast to him in love, who have chosen the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, who have come home to him. The words of the Almighty to those who hold fast in love. I will deliver you. I will protect you. I will answer your prayers. I will be with you in trouble. I will deliver you. I will protect you. I will answer your prayers. Yes, no, not yet, but I will answer you. I will be with you in trouble. This is his promise now in every moment. It's immensely practical. Almighty God, I love you. I am holding fast to you. You have promised to deliver me, protect me, answer me, and be with me. Thank you, God, for this is true. Some of you know this. Some of you have been rescued from addiction. You've been freed from traps. You've been protected from bad words and bad choices and bad people. You pray and you hear God's response regularly. You sense his presence in times of trouble. I know that's part of your life as you've walked faithfully in the shadow of the Almighty. However, the Psalms give us words both to describe what we have experienced and words to describe what we want to experience. And sometimes you aren't feeling these four promises. And you can pray, God, I don't feel your presence. I haven't heard your answer. I feel exposed. I know I'm trapped. Please deliver me, protect me, answer me, and be with me as you have promised. And that can be a regular choice of you to pray. Sometimes you aren't feeling it, and that's when we bring in others as vulnerably and as transparently as we can. Dear small group, I am stuck. I am so angry at this person. Every time I think of her or see her, I want to rage at her. I need to be delivered from this rut of anger. Would you lay hands on me and pray for me? Would you fast for me? Would you ask the elders to anoint me with oil? I need God's rescue. Sometimes you aren't feeling it and you need others. These are promises that the Almighty in whose shadow we dwell makes to us. And we've either experienced it, or we're longing for it, or we're somewhere in between. As I said, the psalm closes with God giving three promises that lift our eyes just a little beyond what is immediate, and they take us to a, quote, horizon just beyond our sight. Those are Kathy Keller's words. They just lift us up above our immediate condition, above all the things that we see. The Almighty says, I will rescue and honor him. There is a glory that God has prepared for each of us. We get to taste it now, but not all of it. not all of it yet. He says, with long life I will satisfy her. We are promised everlasting life that starts now, knowing Jesus, and looks to eternity when we will see him face to face, as we say in our Eucharist liturgy each week. Seeing him will satisfy me. It will satisfy you. All of our dissatisfactions here will be satisfied there. And then the third promise, I will show each of you my salvation. My salvation of body and soul that will actually bring an end to the groaning that all of creation has experienced up to now. That will cease and give way to shouts of worship. We dwell in the shadow of the Almighty, and it comes with us wherever we go. We hold fast to him in love. He rescues us, protects us, answers us, and is with us in all of our troubles. In all of them, he is with us. As we abide in his shadow, we see on the horizon the light of his glory, the satisfaction of eternity, and the end of our groaning in his great salvation. We dwell in the shadow of the Almighty, and we have come home. I want to invite you to stand. There are some words in the New Testament that capture the hope presented to us in Psalm 91. And I want us to say this together from Romans 8 as we transition to singing the strength of the name of the one with whom we dwell. So would you join me? We'll just read this together and then we'll go into singing. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we eagerly wait our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name. Thank you. your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder. There's nothing that's the power to save but your name. There's a strong and mighty tower. Your name, there's a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing.
Confess our faith together through the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. I invite you now, as you're able, to please kneel as we come before the Lord in prayer. Let's pray for the church and for the world. Heavenly Father, you tell us that whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. And so, Lord, teach us how to take refuge in you. Give us courage to turn to you as our fortress and our shield when facing danger or encountering fear. Let us experience the grace of living with you and in you as we travel through all the difficult places of this broken world. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, send down on those who hold public office, especially President Biden, Governor Youngkin, and all our local leaders, the spirit of wisdom, charity, and justice, that with steadfast purpose they may faithfully serve in their offices to promote the well-being of all people. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, you are also the King of all the nations, and so we cry to you now for the people of Ukraine. We ask you to rescue those who are vulnerable from the hands of the enemies so they may live without fear before you all their days. And Lord, we also know that you are the one who can make wars to cease to the ends of the earth. You break bows, you shatter spears, you burn shields with fire. And so now we ask you to save the lives of many people in Ukraine. Make a peace that is strong and not weak. De-escalate this crisis and bring justice to this war-torn land. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, giver of every good gift, look graciously upon your church, and so guide our diocese as we begin the process of electing a new bishop. We ask that we may receive a faithful pastor who will preach the gospel, care for your people, equip us for ministry, and lead us forth in the fulfillment of the Great Commission. And we also thank you for Bishop John and his wife Meg for their faithful leadership over the last 10 years. Help them as they began a transition to a new stage of life. Particularly give them strength and healing as they each address significant health challenges in their lives. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for the many ministries of our own congregation, and we particularly thank you for the work of Chris Stevens and his music teams as they lead us into your presence every week through song. Be present with each one of them as they seek to perfect the praises of your people, to offer us true glimpses of your beauty, so that we might be ready to behold your glory forevermore. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask you in your goodness to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We pray particularly for members of our congregation who are receiving treatment for cancer. We remember especially Bob Patton, Pedro Alba, and B.J. Frank. I invite you now to silently lift up the names of anyone that God has placed on your hearts here today. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people, and in the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls. And to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. And now let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God, first silently and then together through this prayer of confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised the forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and lead you to everlasting life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Jesus says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. I invite you to stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's turn and greet one another with the peace of Christ.
Few announcements for you today. Please join me in welcoming Margaret Eliza Mosteller. This is May. May is the second daughter to Ben and Leslie Mosteller. She's the little sister to Ada. So please join me in praying for and celebrating with the Mosteller family and the birth of little May. There is a QR code in front of you, most likely. And if you have any questions, please scan that with your phone. You can reach out to anyone on staff about just about anything. Scan that with your phone. There's a whole bunch of, I thought I saw the Mostellers. Nope. There's a whole bunch of options there, so it's a great way to get in touch with our staff. Resto Women, we had such a good time. I had such a good time on our retreat in February. I think you all did too. And so we're going to get together this Tuesday night. We'll have fellowship, we'll have snacks. If you haven't ever been and it sounds slightly intimidating, this is such an unintimidating crowd. It is easy to walk into. There's something you can eat, so that makes you feel better. And there will be someone kind to talk to. So consider coming. We're going to do some Visio Divina. This spring, we've been experiencing God through his word. And we're going to experience it through the visual arts because it heightens our awareness to look for him when we see these religious paintings and we look and study it side by side with the scripture context that goes with it. It is very cool if you haven't done it before. So I hope you'll join us 7:30 Tuesday night. And we are continuing to serve our Afghan neighbors. On the front page of our website, you'll see a picture of the Afghan family. I think it's this picture. And there are two ways that you can help out. You can sign up for meal delivery. A lot of you all have done that. Thank you. There's more room to sign up, more meals to be delivered. It is, if you were at the parish meeting, you heard how strategic Karen McNeely and team have been at figuring out how you drive the most direct way to each home, and you're not wasting time. But it is time very, very well spent. So consider signing up for that. And then we are also helping furnish a home for a family that lives a few blocks away. They need some furniture and they need some home maintenance. So all of this information is on the front page of the website, and Hannah Royal's going to run point on that. There's also an Amazon wish list. So if you don't feel like driving, food delivery is not your thing, maybe furniture is. So will you look at that? Will you help serve these neighbors? Thank you for being the hands and feet of Jesus in our community. It is a privilege to know you and be part of you. So with very grateful hearts, let's turn to the Lord, give back to him of all he's given to us.
In you, Lord, I have you stay. Let me not be put to shame. Turn your ear and quickly make safety for my trembling frame. You're a rock and fortress strong. I am lost and cannot see. For your name's sake, lead me on. In your hands, my soul.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and works of mercy and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and with archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. As our celebration continues, I invite you to kneel as you are able. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. And sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all of your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed once for all upon the cross. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. Apart from your grace, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen.
Jesus, Lamb of God, takes away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, takes away the sins of the world. Oh, grant us your peace. Oh, grant us your peace.
This is the Lord's table. It is the narrow way. It is open to all who have been baptized and are following after Jesus. The way that we celebrate this feast together is that ushers will dismiss you by pew, either to the front or to the back. We will take the bread, dip it in the wine, and you can just receive it like this and then partake. If for any reason you don't wish to partake of this meal this morning, we still invite you to come forward. Simply put your arms across your chest like this, and we'd love to pray a prayer of blessing for you. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to him belong. Who holds our days within his hand? Who comes upon I
Stand together.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you
give thanks together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
As you go out, you know that it is cold and unexpectedly so, and so snacks are going to be in the fellowship hall right underneath us. But before you do that, consider this, at the end of Psalm 91, God answers, "When he calls to me, I will answer him.
I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. It's a great invitation that if you call out to God, he'd love to answer you. And so there'll be a team of people that would love to pray for you. You can go right up there after the service and see what it is that you'd like to hear from God. As for everyone else, when you get sent out, the thing that you most want is to know that the shadow of the Almighty goes with you, that throughout this week that you will be able to say, my God is my refuge, my fortress. It is he in whom I trust. To receive this blessing, the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.